write some text, but it has a reason that you see this text. Maybe some of you know that already quite some time ago there was a special CD made by Lionel Pipe with all the fonts made by Herman Sapphire. And on the CD there were also the Euler fonts, because they were designed by Herman Sapphire. And well, depending on if you ever use those fonts, you may have noticed that the ones that you use, if you use them in that document, are actually virtual fonts, which have quite some ugly AMS glyphs combined with the original Euler ones. So that's one thing, and then the other thing is that Euler was made in a time when the techniques that we have for doing these kind of things were not as good as we have now. So when Herman saw the copies of the printouts of that instance of the font, there were, well, he was not pleased. So I think at that moment he was already involved in this redoing the Optimanova, redoing the Palatino, etc. So I think redoing the Euler was a kind of natural thought at that moment. You must imagine that the original Euler font was made not in a time when there was no email between those people, and Don on the other end of the ocean and Herman here. So everything went by snail mail, and at the same time, digitizing a font, because we talk about digitizing, was still something that happens with, well, you take this drawn thing and you put it on paper with a grid, and you pinpoint where you think that the control point or whatever should be, and then, well, you pick out a student and let him key in all these numbers in Metafont, and you hope that something comes out. And as long as you print the things a bit small, you don't see all the problems. And then a few years later, when Herman was writing his life story, he again mentioned the Euler project, which is, I think, a project that he enjoyed very much, and also expressed again the ideas of that some of these things should be improved and should be made nicer. Now it happens that for other reasons, Volker and I and Taco occasionally run into Herman, and I think two times at the Dante Christmas party the topic came up again about this Euler not being as good as he thought it should be. And that's when we said, well, then we should sort it out and make it better. And this is how a project started, where actually we decided with him to improve these fonts. Of course, then you have some kind of official thing, like we had to ask the AMS, is it permitted that we update them? And there was no problem with the AMS doing it. And then you get a question, well, if you update these fonts, you have to make sure the techies stay happy. So you have some constraints, like the dimensions should not change too much. And that actually led to splitting the project in two phases. The first phase is, let's fix the things in the existing Euler. And the second phase is, let's make more glyphs, better glyphs, let's adapt the dimensions and whatever. We are now currently in the second stage. And the second stage eventually will lead to an open type form. The nice thing is that, during the project we were thinking about how should we somehow present the thing to the audience, and the idea came to present it to Don Knoebel. It will just show the differences. So the idea came, let's present it to Don Knoes as a birthday present, and well, Herman liked that idea very much, so we had more time schedule to get the thing fixed. And after that, we contacted the AMS, and AMS has officially adopted the new font, so the new font will be part of the future technology. The biggest challenge will, of course, be will we need somebody to convince Linotype to also replace their version of Euler, because they still on the website have the old one. Okay. Do you see the difference?
And don't tell us that you don't.
Don't tell me.
So
the problem is, these things is there are probably a few people in this room who really can immediately see difference between fonts. I myself am not one of them. If I see the thing small, well, I really have to look very carefully. And by now I know what to look for.
A little more rounded.
But the funny thing is, if you're working together or sitting together with Hermann Zapf for an hour or 2 hours and looking onto these big letters, you finally will see all the difference, and you will see where letters are not the same as the ones or as similar ones. It's really a thing of getting adapted, getting an eye for it, and it takes some time to get an eye for it.
It definitely takes some time, because when Hermann draws, says, I want to have it this or that way, so he is, let's say, draws an R, he really takes a pencil and draws a 10-point character and expects you to see the difference.
That's true, yeah.
And he's 90 and doesn't wear specs, so it's really hard to follow sometimes what he's drawing.
Okay, so what are you can explain the main characteristic differences, yeah? See, not to take the big one. One thing is this.
Hey, but you see it also, you see it very good here.
Mm-hmm. So right is, the green is the new one, and the one on the left is the old one.
A lot has to do with we already had a lot has to do with the strokes, so that's one, the thickness of the strokes. Another thing has to do is, well, if you would really zoom into this one, you would see that it's even funnily curved in the corner. There's a lot of digitization errors in there that have been
just like.
Question. Can I have a question?
Yeah?
Have you seen a bulk text printed with the same text printed in one page, for example? The new and old Euler, and does it show for unprepared reader?
The problem is that so printing the old Euler is nearly not possible, because you can use a text use as a text font, because you don't have any kerning, any ligature kerning mostly, kerning pairs, and so you can't typeset a text. It would look completely different from new Euler text typesetted.
But they did typeset the conference program in 1992 in Euler fonts, and it looks funny in some of the.
You can use the same kernings and then compare. I don't think that unprepared eye will see the difference.
Well, of course, the unprepared eye hardly tells the difference between, you know, times and quality. Arial
and times.
Arial and times, yes. So.
But I think one of the things happening with fonts is that you see them probably in most of documents small, but something like a title or whatever, and then you start seeing the differences. Okay, here's the big parade of we have sheet wise of an hour, so you can show all the differences. Okay,
let's
carry on.
Some will be prominent.
Yeah, sometimes the things are really minor,
yeah,
but very often you see really big differences.
Of discretization.
And this one sometimes shows up large in the document,
But
the last one got higher.
Of course.
Yeah, there are small bumps there.
But
It's mostly the components. Here, for example, you see how it's these lines, how they are running. I think the he is the most prominent example where you.
Can you show the data again?
Oh yeah, that's the one that.
We just took the delta because the original quote has the delta in it. Yeah, there are more prominent characters.
Does it only contain the letters or also the big operations?
This is typically, I think, one of the. If you see it, it's slightly different. This is more the modern SAP. If you also look at the difference with the Optima, you have the same subtle.
It's more subtle, exactly. I mean, this is obviously the design constraints of 30 years ago or something. They were much more crude and they were kind of not really allowed to make, or they weren't very sure if they can stay in certain
boundaries. Mm. That was the first case. In the second case, you could sometimes see that even the coordinates were sort of mistyped. You could see that were just wrong. Yeah, that's very prominent.
So here
so the older one, the new one is shorter.
No, it's longer.
New one is shorter.
Shorter. Yeah, that part.
The green is new and the red is old. Right?
Mm-hmm. And what is light green then?
The light green is the additions.
The difference.
Transparency.
I know.
You can't see the
That's a front mount. That means that
these corners were filled.
Yeah.
In a new version, you have like those ink traps.
No, they are not ink traps.
They're not
ink traps. Anti-traps.
Yeah.
Strange.
Well, I mean that's pretty common in some designs, like many.
And here is no, for example, such trap in five.
It was already there. In the five?
No, in five there is no.
No, there's no.
Strange.
Yes.
Well, one of the things is in this whole process, when we gave you copies, mm-hmm. it took a while before Herman really got up to speed and. Was willing to change everything because in the beginning he still had let's not change
just small
a lot of work, blah blah, and
just do the really important changes. And when he saw that the changes came back in quite quickly, he adapted to the speed, and the workflow was then really really fast. He changed letters to and fro and sometimes back, and
these are quite
a larger punctuation.
Yeah.
Mm.
You see.
Question.
This was wrong. It's a bit more like that. It's gone.
This is really interesting.
Yeah, it's easy. That was before the boundary in which the character has to stay somehow, and so now
it's longer,
left
yeah.
the boundary.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Same here.
Can you get back to the U?
Yeah,
back to the U?
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, go back to the
there's a sharp corner which you could probably only understand.
This one.
But this one is not so sharp. That's okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's it's definitely more like.
But it's it strikes in contrast to the rounding down the down below the curved.
No, but it makes sense because it's like it comes from the writing. It's basically the junction is it would be sharp in
so
from the
pen
open angle.
Pen
like that going in, no.
Anyway, Roma locuta causa finita.
That was strange explanation. Sorry, can you go back? I didn't understand this. If you draw this, then why did the, no the U again? Why the lower one, not the upper one, but the lower junction is just rounded?
Because you have the pen movement that goes like that, so it draws the ink into the stem, and now you have a pen movement that goes like that. Mm-hmm. So basically, any smear that could occur, it could only occur here,
mm-hmm.
because that's the only place where you have an
flows down over into the black.
That's
one.
The only place where you have sort of two parts of ink cross, and there is any and there can be some smear, or it's like the movement of the letter.
I believe that the reverse theory could be also developed. Why there should not be, and there should be a feeling above.
I was just quoting Hermann, how he.
If Hermann were left-handed, then probably he would be a different letter.
Hermann is for all things. Hermann is always talking about the broad pen, etc., etc. Mm-hmm. So he's
mm-hmm.
thinking about drawing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was the letter where you could see where the lines didn't. It was like something like that. It was not something you could see by using a pen. And that was is now sharper and. Strange.
He improved it yet?
Oh. That has to be changed.
come on.
Oh,
come back. The V.
And there is no.
And there is no.
And
there is the same thing where the smear could occur and it didn't.
Of course, because it's a different dynamic. It's a. It's a lowercase letter. The stroke is much more fluid and not so dynamic as in the uppercase.
But you can see above.
Well, he had a better pen.
No, it's just drawn differently. It comes from. I mean, it comes from practice. I did not understand many principles before I didn't start calligraphy. It becomes much more natural when you. Oh yeah, that's like one of the very common limitations of old typesetting systems, that the kern or the arm of the F never reached too much to the right, because there were problems with kerning, and now he revised that, and I think in Palatino as well. He made it longer.
Yeah. The same here. Mm.
Yeah, that was very cramped. Very
yeah, because the but because the G was before
mm-hmm.
lying like that, it's now more the dynamic stroke of the other characters. Yeah, so here.
Is the G was striking in the computer in the concrete mathematics?
It's used in
that was very prominent. It's
exactly. The G was.
Did any single letter stay untouched?
No.
No one. Pretty sure. I think all of them. Finally, they were all. In the beginning, it were some of them, but in total, I think each character.
Mm-hmm. Probably each got a fixture for digitizing the problems. I mean, that
yes,
is
right. It's a mixture.
All these angles, the sharp angles, I have
Can you go back to T? And here you have anti-traps at the top, yeah, not at the bottom of the bar.
Maybe because you first draw.
Because the smear stroke it goes up.
Mm-hmm. You first draw the
smear. Or you draw it.
Well, it may have to do with the order, yeah. Do you first draw this one and then that, or?
No, I do not say that it's improper.
You first do this, and there's so much ink on your pen that
I wouldn't even say that. Everything is 100% correct and consistent, because the number of times we went over that was quite big, and in the end, Hermann was very anxious that we finally did it mm-hmm. until the 10th of January. Mm-hmm. And so the end, he said, okay, that's done mm-hmm. now for now. All the other changes mm-hmm. will come into the Euler model. Mm-hmm.
And also it doesn't have to be 100% mechanically accurate, because then it wouldn't be...
Yeah. Maybe this is better...
Yeah, the space is unchanged, I think.
What was that?
This is one also...
Yeah, it looks quite the same, yeah.
Perhaps...
Uh-huh.
There are quite some changes in fact.
Perhaps Hermann is able to see the whole appearance of the font also.
Yeah, but then
you can imagine that such slight differences will look nice in the whole printing.
You see this?
Yeah.
It's also something you see in Palatino.
And what mm-hmm. about the other sizes?
Oh yeah, very good.
Only 10 point. And the other sizes were just changed in the same way. Mm-hmm. The other sizes are actually scaled.
That's cool. You saw these changes?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But here you can see on the top that he basically made it much more fracture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it was like
a bowl and now it's a cone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know that in original Euler was only scaled.
Yeah, it's scaled, and I think it's the bowl phase even scaled with some widening of stems or whatever. Yeah, it's
but not stems, it was just.
Yeah.
I think Tarko did more or less the same as happened in the original. Mm-hmm. Because it's not, well actually if you look at it, it never really was a metafont.
No.
It was coded in metafont, yeah, mm-hmm. but it was just connecting things mm-hmm. in metafont. Mm-hmm. So
and
now the whole thing is edited in
metafont. Actually there were bare numbers given.
Yeah.
There were no relations,
yeah, exactly.
And special techniques for scaling.
He showed us some samples of original drawn mm-hmm. letters where you could see mm-hmm. the measuring points and mm-hmm. the net, mm-hmm. how they
were
transposed.
All in all, a fine transformation was applied to obtain.
I'm really surprised that there were so many changes in the fracture.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, that one was obviously just bad digitization. You can see the the old outline was just horrible.
Or maybe the modern fracture is.
No, it was just.
Now, new fracture is used.
Hermann was doing the changes in the printouts, the 6 centimeters one. I think each letter was in 6 centimeters printed, and he made the changes by hand, and then Taco went into it and put it into FontForge.
And FontForge is the best tool for such things.
It's okay for this. Mm-hmm.
Since there are no actual optical scales.
This one was really the last one, I think, where it was changed.
Yeah.
The final prints, it really stood out so bold, the original then.
Question about the character set. Is it just the same as the old Euler, or has there was Aleph in Euler, and then there was the Beth and Gimel in the AMS.
Can you go back
into
the
L?
No. Maybe you have
that's
for
completely
quite different.
Slope it, more slope it, and it's okay. Although they are rather straight, so why L is sloped?
Why not?
No, he said
I think
it was
the question.
It was
the question
from
should
the beginning.
Be
no.
Jacko, I think the question should not be why. It should be why not.
No.
Of course.
Come back to L, please.
Well, L
so
has
and before A is.
No. It's script L.
Yeah. Okay. L.
I guess it was because of the white space, of the big web white space in the L.
Maybe.
So if you slope it, then it closes it a bit, otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
I think I remember that Hammond said it was wrong from the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I guess so. Now, when this is like often, if it's followed by a lowercase letter, this huge open white space maybe looked funny.
Okay. That was my guess also, that it's filling the gap.
This was the whole repertoire of characters. What we did is
it's for the last 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
10 minutes is. It's a bit dark.
Yeah, it's too dark.
I cannot.
No, you
influence
it. Is this the only picture you have?
So what we did is, it was ignored, you can tell that.
Yeah, we, Hermann had different stages of this project, different objectives, and at that point when it was going for the presentation of the birthday present to Don, that he said, have you thought about how to present it, how you would do it? And when we didn't come over, Hans said, I will do something. And when we weren't fast enough, the next visit, he showed us what he thinks about Leporello, where an eight-page Leporello, and he showed us how he wanted to have it and what should be on the pages. And we were discussing it and how we could do it, and everything should be presented. All the fonts should be in a visible, the differences, mass characters, and so on. And then we went home and were discussing how we could present the thing on a 8-page Leporello. And we started with a
folding
paper and were looking at it and trying to remember what Hermann has told us about what should be front and what could be seen if it's put together, and we finally decided that the way Don would put it on his birthday on his table, the easiest way would be to have an 8-page Leporello, which is really 16-1.
That doesn't have anything on the back.
Exactly. And when I presented that to Hermann, he said, and he immediately got a meter and start measuring whether it would fit on Don's or how long the table must be for Don, so they could put it there. Yeah? I said, don't be.
By then we already had the thing.
Yeah, the problem, not the problem was, but it was already in production because it was handmade by Willy Egger, and he had the measures, and now we started to discuss what should be on it. And that took us the whole Christmas time till, I don't know,
New Year, yeah.
Yeah, the first days of New Year. And because the first page was immediately accepted as you see it, I could pass it around. The second page.
I can wait, but I can show them.
Yeah. The second page where Hans put. Yeah, that's the first page. The second page where we put the initials of Hermann and Don was not so well accepted by Hermann because don't my name should be there. But he liked the colors. The colors don't come out as the real blue. You should look on the prints. It's and then we had Hans generated all the possible ways a letter could be combined as superscripts in various ways and how it would look like. And Hermann liked that also immediately. This wasn't a big discussion. We had a bit of replacement and shifting around, but Hermann was also quite positive about the arrangement. Everything should be shown in a clear color and a clear placement. And then, do you have all the different designs? The colors are not completely right, but you could see them here. We discussed a bit about colors. We had different colors at the beginning, but finally it was accepted in that way. And
this one took most work.
Which one? This one.
Yeah.
The whole positioning and whatever.
The whole positioning, but the most discussion we got on the next one.
The next one was fast to make, but
yeah, it was fast to make. I could show you. Should we show the first?
You have it still?
Yeah, I have it still. That was you can't imagine the protest. No, the one where the biggest protest came, we left out, but. That was one. It's just. No, it's just.
6A.
Yeah, the idea was to show the difference between the bold and the normal one. So there was some outline trickery and whatever done.
And I finally. Said, I don't know, for 30 minutes with Acrobat Professional and Pit Stop, picking colors for different letters and let Hermann tell which colors he would like, and we finally ended up with colors where Hans said, you really can't print them that way.
Pure magenta. And
yeah, it was really funny the colors which came out, and that was the final thing.
Nice.
Next one is my favorite, my personal favorite, because I told Hans what I wanted to see, and how I wanted to see it, and it came out in a way I said, Hans. Perfect, absolutely perfect. It's better than I could ever imagine that, because it's symmetric. You see bounding boxes. You see the symmetry. You could. It's What should I tell? It's perfect.
You could forget there are actual kind of leaves in a font. It looks really like, you know, a bit or something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then we managed to write the whole idea down, how we started. Yeah. Do you have the?
I don't think so. I first had the version with all kinds of areas and transparencies using outlines in Euler, in broad pen out Euler thingies.
And the borders were random generated. It was a bit Hans-like and.
Do you have
Hermann wasn't.
He couldn't
accept it because his sentence must be more formal, and you want to have it. If the people at Don's birthday would see it, he wants to have it more formal. I could show the original ones. I collected them all because it was a real development
process.
From. That's the CD cover. My job was it to ensure that the thing arrived on 10th of January on Don's birthday table, and the only possibility to get it there without him knowing and asking him was to try to find out where he will spend the day and how it would be that we could present him the thingy without appearing in California. So our first guess was ask Carl whether he knows whether somebody goes to Don's birthday. And Barbara was then asked, and she said, I could ask Tom Rokitsky. And Tom Rokitsky said the easiest way would be just to, and he had the telephone number, just to.
What? The email number of Jill.
Yeah, Tom Rokitsky knew the email of Jill.
Mm-hmm.
And he mailed her, and he said, okay, it was willing. And then we got an email from Jill telling that how the day was planned,
mm-hmm.
and that he would be outside from 10 o'clock till, I think, 2 o'clock. And then the afternoon would be a reception, and the evening some festivity. And then Hans went with the whole package, gave it to DHL after we had checked.
Actually, you then find out that sending something is not that trivial. What I do is at DHL is they scan the packages, and what I saw is the CD.
And that was not on the declaration.
Mm-hmm.
And so the stuff came back, we had to fake a bill.
Mm-hmm.
Which was may not be €0, it had to be in
something. And then they finally accepted it. So never ship the CDs with DHL.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Or tell what's on it. It's probably they have problems putting it into or getting it into the United States.
Mm.
But the thing was came arrived on time. At 12:30, we saw on the tracking system of DHL that it was delivered. And half an hour later, we got an email from Jill that it has been accepted. She has rewrapped it and was presented or will present it to him in the evening. It was, and the next morning we got an email from Don that
an email from Don?
Yeah.
Well,
from the secretary. That he has accepted it, and he was really, really surprised by it, and said he even learn a new word, Leporello. and he wished us good luck in the
next stage
of extending and doing new Euler and Euler Nova.
Is he going to typeset any of his books?
He wanted to have that the TFM, the metrics are kept, so it could just be a replacement without anything. And he liked the design, the new design, and probably he will do the same as with his fonts, just put them in and use them the way.
We don't really have a history system in text distribution, so once they are there,
Yeah. Question about the original Euler fonts consists of the Roman, the script and Fraktur, but then there's an Euler symbol font which was created by Don Knuth, not by Hermann Seffritz, which has the summation sign and the product sign, and some of these are completely different.
No, the characters that are part of the Euler set, and there is, I think that we saw summation sign, are Eulerized. You could see it on the minus and the plus and things like that.
Yes,
they are all Eulerized. What will happen next is that the AMS virtual extensions will be Eulerized.
The arrows and things like that.
I think it's not an AMS but that's extension, it's a Knuth extension of Euler.
Well, I don't think it was an extension, it was just part of the whole thing.
But it was not made by Hermann Zell.
It was not made by Hermann.
Exactly.
But you have adapted those as well.
Those have been adapted as well. And so it's still the same files there. You can copy them off. So we do have actually, because of presentation, we do have a text Euler version. So that you can use in a running text. Which was actually the first time I think that Hermann saw it in a
running text.
Text.
Very nice. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.